Dr. Toffler is a physician in Oregon who's been involved with the Physicians for Compassionate Care for a very long time. he is one of the leading experts on assisted suicide in the U.S. without a question, but on top of it, his experience in Oregon. Recently, he did a presentation for us at Euthanasia Prevention Coalition that we recorded and we've been sharing with people concerning all the lethal drug experiments that are being done by the assisted suicide lobby. And so he is the next to speak. Now, because we're starting at 1:02, if he goes a minute too long, we'll make it work, so it doesn't matter. Dr. William Toffler, if you want to say something about yourself, I'm moving things straight to you.
Well, thanks for letting me be a part of this program. I'm honored to be among Wesley and the other speakers, Gordon and Annette. I've learned already things from them as I have over the last 25 or more years as I've been enmeshed in this whole fight against assisted suicide. I'm going to share some sad issues as well as some very hopeful issues and pick up on where Wesley left off, that we're really not worried so much just about winning so much as winning hearts and minds, and that's what we've done. And I can share some very positive aspects about that when you think we've been at it for more than a quarter century. And where we are right now is not as bad as I think people think. And that presentation, I think, will hopefully share that. I've also just incorporated some of the chat that I just heard and hopefully be responsive to the questions that didn't get answered. Assisted suicide in Oregon, what you don't know can kill you. I want to cover what's gone on over the last 30 or more years in the United States and sort of the politics. I'm going to cover the public perception versus a reality. There is a query, particularly Annette Hansen, who had an unbelievably good talk earlier. I think I need to watch it three times to really hang on to every word that she said. There is a shift in drugs, cost and profit issues involved in that, the efficacy in killing, human experimentation with the first guinea pig being humans, lingering deaths and failures, even with the new so-called research, as it's really not legitimate research, and I'll cover that. It's really unethical what is going on right now, mostly on the left coast of the United States, which includes the state of Oregon, California, Washington states, I should say. Adverse outcomes with this, persistent problems with respect to oversight, as people will reference Canada, as we'll say, or they'll reference the People's Republic of Oregon, and as though everything's going well, and indeed I want to share it's not. The word I said in the chat a little bit, dispassionate care versus compassion. Compassion, as Wesley said, is to suffer with. Dispassion is really to say, as a doctor, I'm a vending machine. Whether you live or die is your choice. It really doesn't matter to me. And so it's important that we always use so-called compassionate care because it's really not. And in fact, whenever you use any of these euphemisms, you always want to preface them with the word so-called, or at least put it in quotes, if you will. And ultimately, it's an inherent conflict of interest. You don't have to be religious to understand that. And I think as in that video, I actually could understand myself in that video about the conflict of interest. And if you didn't see it, we were talking about being a lawyer for the defense and a lawyer for the plaintiff in the same courtroom. And then the arrogance and hubris of Americans that we think as American doctors involved in assisted suicide, that we think we can actually distinguish between the arguments and come down on whichever side. And then that's the judge role. And of course, then we're also the executioners, I said. So I put this slide up here. All these arguments have been discussed today, the issue of rational suicide. That whole term, I heard from one of my colleagues. It was actually, I think, Linda Ganzini, who wrote the articles about the problems with 25% of patients who request assisted suicide are actually meeting the criteria for major depressive disorder, as Annette Hansen pointed out. And I think about 23% of them had major anxiety disorder as well. And as was pointed out with the Michael Freeland case, there was absolutely no recognition about that by the GP, family physician, who prescribed the overdose. These fears and the fears of intractable pain, the fears of being in such suffering that medicine can't get on top of it. And I'm going to talk about that in the next slide. I just put that in there a few moments ago in answer to one of the queries that Charlotte on this call asked. The control and safeguards they are basically illusions. They're meant to protect the doctor. And the reality is that they are there just to get it passed by the public. And ultimately, they are obstacles, as was said by Wesley. It's a so-called dignified death. And I could argue with that till the cows come home, because there's nothing dignified about killing yourself. And in fact, it's a major problem. We're spending hundreds of millions of dollars in the United States trying to lower the rate of suicide. And no one's looking at actual suicide, that is non-assisted suicide, as dignified. We always consider it a tragedy, as was Wesley's opinion about his good friend Francis, who died, that was the genesis of his book, a book that's very good. Even it's not dated at all, because the arguments and the apologetics and the actual harm being done to patients is just as much as ever. It's actually Catherine's question, not Charlotte, forgive me. But she was trying to get figures on particularly challenging terminal symptoms, such as terminal life-ending bleed, fecal vomiting, pain, difficult to control, leptomeningeal mets. These are some of the hard cases, and indeed they are. However, unless definite research, it's difficult to effectively prevent alternative options. You know, I've been a physician, a family physician. I worked in private practice. I worked at the University Medical Oregon Health and Science University for 34 years, and I've started a new practice myself with four other colleagues that allows us to be free with respect in the inherent value of life, all human life at all stages, without having to be canceled, as I essentially was, because I was sharing my opinions, factual opinions, by the way, about early life and end of life. And my new chair is a little more woke than the first two chairs. And so I'm now in private practice, which is very freeing, by the way. It's a highly emotive, as Catherine said, but in my time, even with the difficult cases, there is a legitimate ethical purpose in sometimes using conscious sedation, getting on top of symptoms. One of my colleagues, who was a retired a geriatrician, actually made a home visit, hung a propofol drip, and she basically was hanging the drip that's normally used only with metered dosing in the intensive care unit in the home. She'd never hung a propofol drip. This is done by anesthesiologists and other pain specialists, perhaps, but not by a generalist as she was. And she's, by the way, retired. She wasn't actually practicing. And I made the comment, you know, if her intent was to hang the drip with the idea of relieving symptoms, that would be legitimate, but she did it in a way that was unprofessional. If her intent was to hang the drip so she'd go to sleep forever, that's essentially murder. They threatened the death doctors and their so-called compassion threatened to sue me, because it was an article or a conference, a debate going out to 90,000 physicians. And actually, that's where I first met Wesley, was he called me up and said, "Dr. Toffler, I understand you're being sued for telling the truth." And indeed I was. So point being is that it is ethical to use conscious sedation and then try to keep the person as light as possible and then wake them up. And this, again, I've been practicing for 43 years, and I have not encountered a case where we couldn't keep people comfortable. So real briefly, the timeline, this started back on the left coast with California. There was a ballot measure that was defeated 54-46. And then the next year in Washington, the same thing, a ballot measure 54-46. So at that point in 93, this was not legal anywhere in the United States. It was being done by people like Kevorkian, of course, which was he was an anathema for the assisted suicide, because he showed the living end of it, or the dying end of this, I guess, as his Volkswagen van. And he basically was giving people with his suicide machine injections until he finally did it on 60 Minutes. That was, I think, the Thomas Yauch murder. Basically, he actually showed himself injecting and killing that man, and that actually brought him finally to justice. 1994, they learned from the defeats in Washington and California that the idea of injecting was too impalatable for voters. So they went to this passive Hollywood notion that you could just take a pill and slip off to sleep forever, and the ballot measure did pass. There was an effort to try to reverse course. The Oregon Medical Association reversed from being neutral, the so-called neutral, because being neutral, as I said in the chat, is essentially you either can be for something, against something, or you could be so-called neutral. Well, neutral is not not permitted. So, you know, you're not for permitting it. So well, that's a double negative, that becomes a positive. So you're really for it. So there is no such thing as neutral. And neutral is actually the central issue, the tactic of pro-euthanasia, pro-assisted suicide, is to get people to not be opposed to it, therefore you are for it. You can't be neutral on slavery. You can't be neutral on wife beating. You can't be neutral on child abuse. So this neutrality is a key aspect of their strategy. Do not let people use the word neutral. I once got in a debate where I was opposed, there was somebody for it, and then neutral. And then neutral was Linda Ganzini, who published that article about depression. And she, of course, said, oh, well, some days I feel for it. Some days I'm against it, depending on what the circumstances are. So neutral's not opposed to it. It is absolutely for it under whatever circumstances. In 98, there were 15 deaths, 21 prescriptions given. And by 2019, which is the latest figures for Oregon, they come out next month in February generally, there are 290 prescriptions given, 188 deaths. One might ask, what happens to those prescriptions, those deadly prescriptions, after somebody doesn't take them, the person died naturally? That's one of the dangers of this whole practice of assisted suicide. So there are states, as have been said, seven if you don't count Montana, eight if you count Montana, where it's really, as Dr. Hansen said, not really legal. It's just you won't be prosecuted because it's not against the Constitution if you just acted in good faith, so to speak. And that's a sad reality. But on the other hand, what you're not seeing is a map where the vast majority of the United States is not in favor of medically assisted suicide at all. In fact, there was prediction by people like Derek Humphrey, we've taken the first step, there's going to be a domino effect, if you will. And the reality is between January of 1994, 27 years ago, and February of this year, or of last year, 2020, there were 284 proposals. More than 43 states and the District of Columbia considered this. Yet, over and over again, bills were either defeated, tabled for the session, withdrawn by sponsored, or language with no action taken. So the vast majority of the time, these are defeated because we have been successful at educating the public, people like Alex, people like Rita Marker, and myself, Wesley Smith, Annette, all of us have done our best to be proactive and not passive about this, because it is not an inevitable domino effect, quite the contrary. And as was shown earlier, there are only a handful of countries, less than a dozen, out of 197 or so countries that have embraced this. So we are being effective. The only problem, this is the sad part, was once you let the camel's nose get under the tent, once you let the genie get out of the bottle, whatever metaphor you want to use, it is virtually impossible to reverse it. I can think of only one state off the top of my mind, New Mexico, that embraced it, where it ultimately was then rejected afterward. What is said, if you have it in place, and especially if the people voted on it, is that you're now going against the will of the people. And so it is easier to reverse something from the legislature than it is from the plebiscite, the people. And you desperately have to avoid having that go down. Even 51-49, when we tried to reverse it, it ended up being 60-40, because the argument no longer was about assisted suicide. It was going against the will of the people. So why is it that we've been successful so often? Well, assisted suicide is a problematic paradigm. Actually, the Canadians realized this. They actually did the research. They saw the vomiting, the intractable problems with the pills, the people who didn't actually die. And so they went directly to euthanasia. And in fact, I think, unless Alex can correct me, but at one point, just a year or so ago, there were only five people in Canada that had been, their lives were ended with assisted suicide. The vast majority.
Less than that. It's less than five.
All right, thanks. And so the reality is that if you want to kill someone efficiently, you do exactly what you do with capital punishment, where you give a sedative, you put the person somewhat into a soporific state, and then you give them a medication that will There's three steps. I'm blocking in the second step, but the third step, of course, is to give a lethal medicine. And there's an anti-anxiety in there, and there's one other one. And Alex, you're going to help me with that, because I'm having a Biden moment here. All right. So the lingering deaths I've talked about, they last. Sometimes you're unconscious. Sometimes it takes 5 to 32 minutes. But the death could be way out, 11 and a half hours. Or there was a case in Michael Pruitt or David Pruitt in 2005. He had lung cancer. He was given the usual dose, a deadly cocktail. His wife respected his choice, and she was being passive about it, because that's what we're taught, is we're supposed to respect autonomy and choices. He woke up 65 hours later, and I'm doing my best to paraphrase and quote him. He said, "What the hell happened? I thought I was supposed to be dead." But he had an epiphany with that. He said, "Well, you know, God must not want me dead." And he lived 11 days after that. His wife was elated that she had an extra almost 2 weeks with him. And she basically came to realize and appreciate him and was compassionate with him. He died naturally, a dignified, natural death. And that's the point. Death with dignity doesn't mean that you don't go through problems. I mean, my late wife, she died about six and a half years ago of metastatic leiomyosarcoma of the uterus. And while, yes, there were difficulties in those last 5 years, but we both knew that she was inevitably going to die, because it was an incurable cancer. The best chemotherapy could do is help her with symptoms. But, you know, there were difficulties, but there was also great joy, because I think that you recognize how important, how special life is when you know you're going to die. We all know we're all going to die, but it's in the back of our minds. And so, yeah, I think in that last 4 or 5 years, I think we only had one argument that time, and it was over in about 20 minutes, which is a very different rate of arguing than in the first 35 years of our marriage. We were married for 40 years, had 7 children. So there's a specialness about that, if we can embrace that aspect of our lives, which, by the way, none of us can escape. So the David Pruitt case is an example of what is wrong with this, is that it literally is not an efficient way to kill people. And again, I'm not favoring assisted suicide as a solution to suffering, but nonetheless, that's the paradigm that we're against. And Derek Comfrey, I mentioned him earlier. I've debated him twice. He's actually an easy person to debate, because he's actually somewhat fairly honest about it. But, you know, he wrote the book Final Exit, and he actually wrote a book for his disciples, Lawful Exit, about how to actually do this. But he was commenting on the David Pruitt case. He says, it's a miserable path to death. Doctors prescribing aren't there at the time of death. Doctors should be able to give a lethal injection. There's honesty for you. Lingering deaths can take up to 2 days, he says. And he shared a case of a man who was still alive at 7 hours, and his father was so uncomfortable watching his son that he took a pillow and smothered him. This is actually in his writings and in his books. So why do people swallow this pill, this euphemism? Well, it's euphemisms that the so-called death with dignity, the so-called choice in dying, these are things that sound good. They're not. Assisted suicide, if you use the word assisted suicide, they lose about 15% of favorability toward assisted suicide if you use the King's English, the actual words. It's perceived as a passive act by the doctor. So you're just honoring patients' wishes. And that's why many people want this. It's, again, as I said, the Hollywood image. Well, in Southern California, actually in San Francisco area, so it's in the middle of California, it's a Dr. Lonnie Shavelson. So as soon as it was passed in California, assisted suicide by the legislature, in a cost-saving session, by the way, this is when they did it, it was a special session convened by the governor to deal with the cost overruns in the state of California. And lo and behold, they brought up assisted suicide and it passed. So he sets up a death clinic in San Francisco, but he wasn't just involved in it at that point in time. He was involved much earlier. In fact, in his 1995 book called A Chosen Death, Shavelson described watching a Hemlock Society leader, Sarah, that's the name of the leader, murdered a disabled man, Gene, who changed his mind about being assisted in suicide. So Shavelson was invited into Gene's home, and Sarah handed Gene the poisonous mixture. And she's very lighthearted about it. It says, "Okay, Toots, here you go. Jean then drinks the liquid and began to fall asleep as Sarah put the plastic bag over his head. Then, suddenly faced with the prospect of immediate death, Jean screamed, "I'm cold," and tried to rip the bag off of his face, but Sarah wouldn't allow it. His good hand, this is a quote from her book, his good hand flew up, he had only one arm that worked, flew up and tried to tear the bag off of his face. Sarah's hand caught his hand and at the wrist and held it. His body thrust upward, she pulled his arm away and lay across Jean's shoulders. Sarah rocked back and forth, pinning him down, her fingers twisting the bag to seal it tight at his neck as she repeated, "The light, Jean, go toward the light." And Jean's body pushed against Sarah, then he stopped moving. So this is the so-called death with dignity. So it was very interesting with respect to the response to this, is Lonnie Shavelson basically thought that this was a horrible death, so you had to have these kind of things more efficient. So he's the one that's actually working on different ways to make this happen. The other problems that I haven't mentioned, by the way, and I'm not going to be able to be exhaustive in this short time. In Oregon, there's really no tracking of this. The reports that coming to the government are second and third hand reports. The doctor is not present at the time of death 85% of the time over the 23 or so years that it's been tracked. There are ulterior motives, and I'll talk about those momentarily. The ulterior motives include a case that came to light, Tammy Sawyer. It's fraud against her client, Thomas Middleton. She was actually acting as a trustee. She's a real estate agent, and Thomas Middleton is her client. He basically named Sawyer, Tammy Sawyer, the trustee, and he actually instructed her to rent his home until the market values in Bend, Oregon were better. And instead, within 2 days of his death, she listed the home for sale immediately, deposited $90,000 of his money into her own account. And all of this only came to light because she was actually fraudulent in many other ways that the government actually investigated. They never actually prosecuted her for this because she was such a fraud in so many other ways. So the state reporting system and the doctor who gave the overdose to Thomas Middleton, the ALS patient, the patient with Lou Gehrig's, never found out about any of this. This never would have come to light. And this is the point I think that Dr. Hansen made earlier, is who's ever tracking this? I have never asked a patient in my 43 years, who stands to benefit when you die? And so the problem with this paradigm is not just simply on a medical level, it's on a societal level. So there are health cost pressures, as everyone on this call knows. In the old days, we would do things that legitimately, back when I first became a doctor, we'd be beating on people's chests where we should have perhaps gotten advanced directives and what were their wishes, how much would be done before you considered it futile. And those conversations are useful. Although I can tell you this, it depends on who's asking them. And I can tell you there's bias among some of my colleagues is to move toward what's the use of your continued living is the bias of a doctor, projecting that on a patient. And how we ask questions, are they truly open-ended, or are we having a leading question like you often see reporters on the news? So the cost pressures are real. There's a case of Barbara Wagner that happened in 2008. She was a cancer patient, a retired school bus driver, and an oncologist prescribed chemotherapy to slow her cancer. The Oregon Health Plan, instead of approving the drug Tarceva, which wouldn't have cured the cancer, but would have given her about a 46% increased chance of being alive in a year, refused to pay for it. But they would pay for her assisted suicide drugs. They were 100% covered in the same letter. So it's somewhat chilling when the government, now two of these patients came to light because there was an astute reporter that actually did reporting at the Eugene Register Guard. And otherwise, again, none of this would have been captured because of the shroud of secrecy covering the reporting system in Oregon. So whatever, and I was asked by a Spanish reporter recently who was asking lots of questions about assisted suicide, and it seemed like after more than 20 years, things going swimmingly, according to the official government reports. And she said, well, the Barbara Wagner case was a long time ago. The Michael Freeland case was a long time ago. Well, that's true. But it is also true that you can't get at this information because it's actually protected. In fact, the state of Oregon actually shreds the records after they've taken and collated the data about how many hours it took to die, what was reported by a second or third hand person, that kind of thing. And they actually destroy the records. So you could never retrospectively go back and look at what really happened. What questions were asked about, are you depressed? Are you anxious? Are you feeling hopeless? All these kinds of things are, it's impossible to track that then. So the food to car is, you know, is there too much care being given today or really too little? In practice now, I have to fill out virtually every day a prior authorization. I have to get some bureaucrat in an insurance company to approve that I want a CT scan for my patient or an MRI. And so there's tremendous pressure to limit care. You've heard the story in Canada where I want to have my cataracts out. Well, it'll be 9 months. I'm already getting that. I referred one of my patients with a complex neurological problem to a neurologist. Well, your appointment will be in May because she happens to be on the state Medicaid plan, which doesn't pay as much as other payers. And so she's put at the bottom of the list. And think about this. There's this concept of quality life years. It's a theoretical concept in the literature. Well, what is it for? It's to make decisions about who gets the care and who doesn't. Or think about it in today's terms, a COVID vaccine, who gets it and who doesn't. So you've got literally a committee in Oregon of 27 people who are arguing about which group is more deserving of a vaccine than another group, when in reality, the simple science is this. You would save almost 80% of the deaths in Oregon if you gave it to people over 70 years of age. Those are the facts. I actually just recently wrote a letter to the editor saying that. And you got people fighting about this group because of their skin color is more deserving than that group. It's just pathetic. When the actual medical facts are simply give it to the people who are really vulnerable, that is the 70 and year and older, not to the 30-year-old school teacher, not to the 30-year-old ER nurse. And by the way, you know, if they asked me and I were that young and they wanted to give me the COVID vaccine, knowing what I know about ethics, I'd say, don't give it to me, give it to somebody who's really at risk. In fact, just FYI, I had COVID over Thanksgiving and basically there is life after COVID. Would I wish it on anybody? No. But thankfully, I'm a healthy 71-year-old. And so it's not something that was critical for me. It is critical for people who have lung disease, diabetes, overweight, all the hypertension nonetheless. So you have these ethics consultations now about something as simple as vaccine or who gets a respirator. That's been a stance in throughout the country when there was a real sense that respirators helped. Actually, they don't help. You don't want to be on a respirator if you have COVID, if you can at all avoid it. So there is a bitter taste with the original cocktails that had to be masked with ice cream and that sort of thing. So they quickly, the death doctors developed ways to make the emesis inevitable and now emesis, the vomiting, less likely. So they give dancitron, which is a very powerful antiemetic, and metoclopromide about a half hour or more before taking the deadly mixture. The lingering deaths we've talked about. The cost of drugs, though, rose exponentially. And so you now have a tremendous drift. Secinol used to cost less than $100. It's now costs $3,600. You say, why is a drug that's about 60 plus years old so expensive? Well, it turned out that it wasn't very profitable. So a company named Valiant bought the drug. And basically, they decided to make a big profit since they had a corner on the market. And so they just drove the price up. It wasn't because it was much more expensive to make. And so this is the reality. So it drove the death doctors to have to do human experimentation. And that's underway even as we speak. And the lead researcher is Dr. Lonnie Shavelson, I mentioned. So the time from ingestion of medicine is now median to sleep is about 25 minutes, but it could be up to 4.3 days as it was in David Pruitt's case. And so now they've got it down in 2016 with these deadly cocktails to 7 minutes and 9 hours is the other end of limit. But of course, they don't do really quality research. This is not with peer reviews, not with human subjects review committees and universities. So they only have reporting on 25 out of 133 patients. 108 deaths are unknown in their research. So I mentioned the pre-medication. I mentioned Secanol that was developed in 1930 and sold for pennies a pill, and it's now 3,600. And so we now have the trial and error being led by Dr. Shavelson on cocktails. They call it DDMP1 and DDMP2. What do the DDMP stand for? It's digoxin, diazepam, morphine, and propranolol is the first one, the DDMP1. And then there's that, but it still wasn't very efficient. I mean, you got to sleep in about 9 minutes, but the death could be up to 1.3 days. So they're still working on it on human subjects with no real background in terms of research. They're just trial and error. And it's reformulated now to DDMP2, which is doubling the dose of digoxin. So what they're doing now is they're giving digitalis, which we used to be conscious of. We used to do dig levels and we used to use dig a lot. And basically they doubled it from 25 milligrams to 50 milligrams. Now these doses are somewhere between 100 to 200 times the normal dose that you give to a person, each one of them. Digoxin's 25 milligrams, diazepam's 1 gram, morphine is 15 grams, and propranolol is 2 grams. Now, you're normally given propranolol like 10 milligrams, and this is the kind of thing. Digoxin was 0.25 milligrams. Diazepam might be given 10 milligrams is probably the highest dose as a family physician that I would give somebody, and I usually try to get them off of it because it's not a good drug to take in general. You know, we weren't born with a diazepam deficiency. So it prompted the reformulation. And so they sometimes substitute, instead of propranolol, which isn't quite deadly enough, they'll actually put amitriptyline in there, which is an old antipsychotic, antidepressant agent that I used in residency first. I hardly ever use it unless I've got somebody who needs to gain weight, because it predictably does that. And I have to tell them a preamble of, be sure you don't take too much, because I remember in full-time practice in Sweet Home, 2 hours south of here, that was one of my first overdose patients I had to take care of for 2 or 3 days in an ICU because she took an overdose, and it wasn't pretty. This is not so-called death with dignity. See, the Oregon prescription drugs used have almost completely gone right now in 2019, the last year we have records from the Oregon Health Department, to the DDMA mixture, which is the digoxin, diazepam, morphine, and amitriptyline, or Elavil, as it used to be called, or is a brand name. That's where we are. So we still have lingering deaths today in Oregon because we aren't as efficient as the Canadians are with euthanasia. By the way, euthanasia doesn't work all the time. And so when they were first recommending this bill and the doctors were embracing it eagerly, it seemed like, even people who were so-called neutral on it embraced it. And I remember listening to one of them on the Canadian TV talking about this bill. And he was saying, well, you know, in case the first three drugs don't work, the injection, basically, you know, the sedative is the first, I mean, the anti-anxiety drug is the first one. Then there's a sedative to put them to sleep. And the third drug is basically a muscle paralyzing agent. That's the efficient way to kill. But what they were recommending is that all doctors have 2 euthanasia kits. The first one to usually work, and the second one, of course, in case the first doesn't work, as it doesn't work sometimes, even in prisons and the like. And that's part of the reason why most people who are opposed to the death penalty, they talk about it as being cruel and unusual punishment. So if that's the case in prison, why isn't it the case in real life? It's a mystery to me. So the current paradigm, I mentioned, it's really dispassionate care by biased doctors who are often promoting assisted suicide. There's a minority. This is other good thing in the state of Oregon. There are about 14,000 active practicing physicians. There are only about 200 doctors who are actually engaged in this act. And you have to ask yourself, why is that? What is it about this act that most doctors have an inherent sense of this? This isn't right. This is an inherent conflict of interest. There's clearly the issue of unethical research being done in all three of the left coast states. It's numerous problems. They have not overcome them. There's no real oversight standards or safeguards. And so finally, I just say, it is intertwined with financial incentives. 1 out of 10 people in the United States are elderly people, my age and older, have elder abuse in their life. That's according to Margaret Doerr, a lawyer in Seattle, who her specialty is elder abuse. So she's, from a very secular point of view, Margaret Doerr is actively opposed to assisted suicide and euthanasia. She sees the ultimate elder abuse is ending somebody's life because they're a burden on you, or you stand to gain from them. The concept of 6 months to live is the way these bills are written. Some of them are now extending it to 12 months, is absolutely subjective, impossible to determine. It truly is crystal ball reading. Everyone knows cases of people who are alive years after somebody said they only had months to live. So the expansion is inevitable. The slippery slope is real, as was said. In Oregon, there was a bill before the legislature to change the word ingest, which generally most people would think of, you're eating a meal, you're taking a pill, whatever, to include injection and to include inhalation of deadly gases, and also rectal administration. And the head of medical oncology at Oregon Health and Science University was there testifying before the legislature while I was present, and this is exactly what he was saying. And fortunately, it did not pass. And oddly enough, both the promoters of assisted suicide didn't want it to pass, and certainly they joined with us who didn't want it to pass. And you say, why would the promoters of assisted suicide not want to expand it to include these more efficient ways of killing? Well, the reason is because they had about 25 states that were trying to pass this this bill, and basically they were going to jeopardize the campaigns in the other 25 states if they let the cat out of the bag, that we're really not going to limit it with these so-called safeguards. So the shroud of secrecy, the elimination of safeguards is underway. They did manage to pass, so there was a 15-day waiting period here in Oregon, and now it's essentially one day. Why? Because if a doctor says they're really on a rapid course to death, then you have to make sure the law changes so that you can actually do this before they die naturally. Hurry up and kill them with an overdose before they die naturally. This is exactly what passed in Oregon at the same hearing, the same legislative session, where they at least did not allow the word to ingest to be basically corrupted to mean things that ingest doesn't mean. We've talked about depression screening is not required, and it's certainly not done. That has not changed at all through the course of the year. At best, in a given year, 5% of patients are referred to the capable hands of people like Dr. Hansen. And there's no requirement for hospice and palliative care. And in fact, as I said in the chat, if people saw that, in Oregon, sadly, we are not following the paradigm of Dame Cicely Saunders. We are following, in some cases, the paradigm of Derrick Humphrey, where now hospice used to have to stand outside the door if assisted suicide was involved or invoked. Now they're actually inside the house where the hospice and the assisted suicide is taking place. So they're essentially collaborating with the and ending of life artificially with overdose. So it's a sad thing. And by the way, I'm on a subcommittee looking at the problems with palliative care and hospice. Palliative care is not so bad, although some of the palliative care people run hospices that are actually corrupt. In Texas, there was somebody who was working on making more money by fraudulently reporting how long people had to live to enter a hospice. He's been successfully prosecuted. He essentially skimmed off the top $200 million with his scheme of putting people in hospice that didn't meet the criteria. And so this is, all hospices aren't equal, created equally. And the last comments I'll make are that there's no requirement to have family involved, people who might care. And I remember one of the families I've known for years, his father was in California, came to Oregon on a suicide tourism, and he was going to kill himself on Easter Sunday. This family happened to be very Catholic, Orthodox Catholics from the Lebanese Rite at St. Charbel's here in Portland. And it would have been devastating to them, not only that he's killing himself, but he's doing it on Easter Sunday, which is a major holiday. I knew the death doctor. He was one of my colleagues at OHSU, and I informed him of this problem within the family. And fortunately, he was sensitive to it and talked to the man wanting to end his life, so at least he did it on a different day. But it's just sad that it tears apart families. They're not necessarily involved. So it undermines essentially the doctor-patient trust. the vulnerable and underserved, as was said, are at risk, especially the disabled. The not dead yet group is a very formidable group, as Wesley Smith said, and they are very effective, saying they realize that this paradigm is meant for them. Their quality of life years are down. And so people are saying, well, I'd rather be dead than live like that person. So I'll end there, and hopefully we'll have a couple questions and time for that. And I appreciate that.
The U.S. has devolved from being able to debate this subject to being canceled if you have a position that they are labeling as intolerant. Literally, what the Hippocratic Oath went from being in only one medical school in 1993, as documented by Edmund Pellegrino of the Georgetown Ethics Center. In fact, I think it's actually named after him now. He was a giant with one of the first and really true ethicists. Now, if you're an ethicist, you can't really have an ethic in medical schools. So in U.S. medical schools, you are not considered a very tolerant person. In fact, some people would even say you're hateful if you are against a patient's autonomy. And as has been said by people, this is becoming a criteria for entry into medical school, just as being open to abortion was a requirement for entry into OBGYN residencies. So the reality is that this is dangerous. I can be standing at graduation or the white coat ceremony next to somebody who does assisted suicide, and we can take the exact same oath. And why can we do that? Why can we both sincerely take the same oath? Because it simply says, I will try to do good and defend the patient-doctor relationship. And that is so subjective that it essentially is meaningless. So there is no teeth, there is no substance, there is no boundary, as there was originally, that I will not give a deadly drug, even if asked, as was known to be important even 2,400 plus years ago. So that's the long and the short of it. Somebody said it's important to me because I'm getting healthcare in the U.S. And so you really do have to ask your doctor where they stand on these things. Because if you have somebody who believes that they're neutral or they're for it, your life is in danger.
Dr. Toffler is a leader in Physicians for Compassionate Care, which is an organization that started in the 90s, early 90s, actually, to fight the assisted suicide law in Oregon originally. And there's Physicians for Compassionate Care in other places also, such as Washington State, et cetera. It's a group that has a great history, and its leadership has, amongst their leaders, they have this, probably one of the greatest knowledge points for any organizations that oppose assisted suicide in the U.S. and certainly worldwide. I consider Dr. Toffler to be not only a friend, but one of the top people on this issue anywhere, to say the least. Someone who certainly understands the issues, as you could tell when he was describing these terrible killing drugs and how exactly how they work and what they use. He certainly knew what he was talking about.